Welcome to Questions for Christians. This is where a Christian and an atheist have an interesting and intellectual discussion. Today my guest is Neil Mammen. He's a apologist, a Christian apologist. And welcome to the show, Neil.
Thank you very much, Bernie.
Yeah, in a few minutes I'll let you introduce yourself. First I'll explain who I am a little bit. My name is Bernie Dehler. I was raised a Roman Catholic up until college time. I became a born-again evangelical Christian right after college in 1984. I got a four-year degree in electronics engineering, and I've been working in the computer industry ever since. Part-time, I got a seminary degree from Luther Rice Seminary. It's called a Master's in Ministry degree. I got that in 2007. In 2009, I left the faith and became an atheist. But before I left the faith, I was also interested in evangelism and apologetics, and I had a part-time ministry that I ran to preach the gospel on TV and the internet. I also wrote a booklet after I left the faith in 2009. It's called Modern Science and Philosophy Destroy Christian Theology. For me, that's why I left the faith, is because of modern science and philosophy. I've done a lot of debates and discussions in the Portland area here with other Christians, some pastors, some philosophy professors, for example. And one last thing I'd like to say is that, you know, if you say that you know that God exists because you just feel him in your heart, I want to say I know what you mean, because I've been there. I felt like I felt the presence of God and was led by God. But now I see that it has to be a God delusion, because I'm now convinced that the evidence points overwhelmingly that there is no God that exists. So once again, Neil, welcome to the show, and take a minute to explain to the audience who have maybe never heard about you, what kind of books have you written? What kind of apologetics ministry do you have?
Well, my name is Neil Mammen. I am a amateur apologist. I am an engineer during the day. Pretty much similar to Bernie in that sense. And I've written four books. The one that Bernie and I discussed before is called Who is Agent X? Proving that Science and Logic Show that It's More Rational to Think that God Exists. And then I've written a couple others on politics. Jesus is involved in politics. Why aren't you? Why isn't your church? Another one called 40 Days Towards a More Godly, very similar to the first one, again, on politics and Christians and the critical reason why Christians need to be involved in politics. And then a couple other books that are in the process, one, and then a few more offshoots of that, politics books. And then a couple other books in the process. One of them is called No Blind Faith, basically proving that blind faith is dangerous. And here's where Bernie and I agree 100%. It's dangerous, it's stupid, and it's unreasonable. And you should never have blind faith in anything. So my background is I was born in Ghana in Africa. I grew up in Sudan and Yemen, both Arab nations under Sharia law. But my parents were Christian Indians from South India. My dad was a communist and an atheist until he became a Christian. Many of my uncles are communists, and here I am, a free market capitalist. So there you go. So that's my background.
So I think another thing we might both agree on is the power of logic and trying to determine what you believe. Like you said, it's more rational to believe in God, and I say it's more rational not to believe in God. But yeah, we both agree that we should appeal to our intellect to determine these things?
Absolutely, 100%. In fact, and we'll talk about this later on, is what would it take? If someone can disprove God exists, I would stop being a Christian, and that's, I think that goes hand in hand with not having blind faith.
Okay. So basically the show, we're going to try to touch on five topics. These were five topics that I picked. I thought they were kind of interesting, and you said, okay, let's go for it. So the first one is talking about machines. Are machines getting an awareness? And if so, can they be treated as humans? And this goes to the question of, these machines have souls? Do people have souls? What's the difference? The second one is about neurology. Does the modern science of neurology now show that there's no such thing as a soul? The third one is the gospel nonsense? How does this make sense in our modern world, especially the ideas of sacrifice? And number four is, what would it take for Neil to stop believing in the existence of a God? And the fifth one is, what would it take for me to start believing in the existence of God? And then if we have time, we'll do some bonus material after that that we'll post on YouTube. So are we ready to begin?
Let's do it.
Okay. So the first question, basically this is about machine life. Personally, I have this belief that, you know, if you look at the grand cosmos, there's this grand scheme, grand origins story that you can talk from a naturalistic viewpoint, from an atheist viewpoint, that, you know, from the Big Bang, we had, basically there was not anything material existing. From that, we had matter, and then from matter arose biological life. And I think going forward, we're going to see a machine life, a machine sentience, an awareness, which is different than our awareness and is actually superior. And so I think we're starting to see some of the fruit of that already about machine life. And so recently, just in the last week or so, there was an article about driverless cars, and it was saying that the Google car basically is a self-driving car, and it's self-driving to the extent that even there is no steering wheel. So basically the driver, the so-called driver of this car, is really just a passenger. There is no driver of the car other than the Google operating system. And so Google petitioned to get the car recognized as a driver, and the transportation department agreed with Google that yes, the car is a driver, and that the person who owns the car is basically just a passenger. So I think this is going to be an interesting thing going forward, where if there's a car accident, can they actually sue Google and basically treating the car as a person? And so just to give some more background information on this, is that we know just in general, computers have been getting closer and closer to intelligence, human intelligence. So for example, Deep Blue is a computer that won at chess. So now the chess champion now is a computer. Watson was a computer. I believe both of these, Deep Blue and Watson, were developed at IBM. Watson beat at the game of Jeopardy. So now Jeopardy is where you have a trivia game. And so now the best player at Jeopardy is a computer. And now we have cars that drive so well, they do not let the humans drive. And this is the Google car. So what if you take all of these applications and roll them up into one, you know, maybe 20 years or 50 years from now, these are just apps in your smartphone. I mean, this kind of awareness, it just kind of shows where things are going. You know, and some people now have, there's a Siri program on Apple products where you can talk to Siri and say, like, Siri, what is the meaning of life? And it'll say, oh, that's easy, the meaning of life is, and it'll probably read something from Wikipedia or something, or a dictionary for a definition. But it's interesting that you could have a conversation with computers, and people are now developing relationships with computers. And it's like, if you didn't know that was a computer, you might actually think that was a person, because you can have a conversation with it. And people are going to come to the point where they can say, I swear that computer has got a soul, because it's got an attitude. It seems like it has its own mind. It's learning and talking with me. So Neil, can you see my point that computers are getting so advanced that, you know, if that computer doesn't have a soul, then why would you say a human has a soul? Because really, what's the difference? The computers are going to be self-learning and having attitudes and opinions. What's the difference?
Well, I see, I would agree with you. If by soul we mean the functioning of the mind, then absolutely. I mean, if we are just meat machines and the computer is a silicon machine with some, you know, some fiberglass thrown at PCB, then yeah, we are the same as a computer, and the computer could have a soul just as well. I I don't believe that. I don't buy that. And there are fundamental problems when you go back into, and this comes back to the, first of all, there are fundamental problems. Where did matter come from? Where did life come from? These are questions that science has been unable to answer, right? We have, the best answer we have is it accidentally happened. And this is a nice theory, but there's no way to prove it. We can't say that this is exactly how, I mean, the abiogenesis has been disproved by Pasteur since the 18th century. So yet here we are again saying, yeah, abiogenesis is the reason why life exists. And then we're saying, well, why does it matter? Just a big bang somewhere. Well, I believe the big bang was banged by a banger, right? So these are the differences. But let's go a step further, I think, because that, you know, we understand those differences.
I would have some difference of opinion on you, but I want to kind of, it seems like that's kind of going off topic. I mean, I want to bring it back to, you know, the computers.
So I want to come back. I mean, and we know that we disagree on those issues, right? So we both disagree on those issues. So we understand that. But let me explain why.
Well, I also disagree on your statement about abiogenesis, that it was disproven. But yeah, abiogenesis. Yeah. But we can talk about that later.
We can talk about that. I didn't mean to slip in a debatable issue there. we can definitely cover that if you wish. But what my point is, is that I think that if you were to take somebody's mind and you were to start cutting it up, right, at no point will you find the part of his mind that makes up who he is, right? And that part does not exist. And so let me suggest something different, right? Let me suggest an alternative possibility. At the point of the Big Bang, and we've had this discussion before, the point of the Big Bang, we have calculated that there could be as easily up to 10 other dimensions. Four of them we know of, and that is height, length, breadth, and time. Those are the four dimensions. But there are six other possible dimensions that they've calculated are feasibly there, and the Large Hadron Collider was built so that they could send a particle into one of those dimensions. So this isn't all just science fiction. This is stuff that we are hopefully going to prove in the next few years. If there are other dimensions, then these would not be the natural dimensions. These would be the supernatural dimensions. And so therefore, if there is an intersection, the mind and the body, just like you are a two-dimensional being, you have no comprehension of a three-dimensional being, yet I could not only be as close to you, if you're a two-dimensional being on a piece of paper and I touch you, I would be touching you, I could even be inside, you would not know that because you only understand those two dimensions, that I'm a three-dimensional being. So in the same way, if we are, let's say we have a fifth-dimensional mind or entity, and that is our soul, that intersects with our material, our meat machines, and works those meat machines. And maybe there's some sort of symbiotic or some sort of easily disengageable relationship between that fifth dimension and our four-dimensional beings that when that is severed, something different, you know, the death of the body results in something with the soul and so on and so forth. I think this clearly can explain, scientifically, mind you, the relationship between the soul and the body.
Well, you said that could explain it, but you're just appealing to a mystery. I mean, we don't know how many dimensions there are and all that. I mean, some people might say when you bring up there could be all these dimensions and all these things we don't know, therefore it could explain this. I mean, you can say that about any mystery. It's like, how does this make sense? This doesn't make any sense because of A, B, and C. Well, you know, there may be other dimensions. That's how you could explain it.
Although I think it's limited. I think there's limited explanation power that you have because we're saying material things have material causes, but this is a supernatural cause. The soul part of it. Oh, okay, again, now, there's no way I can prove this to you. No. I agree 100% there's no way I can prove it to you because all it does is it provides explanatory power, right? Now, I do know that we do think that there are multiple dimensions, and I do know that when you start looking at these multiple dimensions, the intersection of these dimensions can explain spirits, can explain demons, can explain the angels. We do know that there has to be a extra natural dimension, that is something outside of the universe, because whatever created the universe was not inside the universe. So whatever caused the Big Bang had to be outside of time, outside of space, and outside of matter. Had to be not dependent on energy, because energy, time, and space all were created at the Big Bang. But, so whatever caused the Big Bang was extra-dimensional in that sense.
Okay, but again, you're saying these extra dimensions can explain things like demons and these unknown things, but you're basically
supernatural dimensions.
But you're basically appealing to another unknown again. You're appealing to unknown dimensions to explain an unknown.
Yes.
So it doesn't really explain anything.
It does explain things, but the thing is that we have not yet been able to prove it. Now, once we get into the intersection of the multidimensional, once the Large Hadron Collider is able to prove to us that there are other dimensions, and I actually think there are other dimensions. I think all the science points to it. I think scientifically we can say, yes, there is, all the equations point to it. I don't think there's any real question about these other dimensions.
Okay,
real question is, can we interact with these other dimensions?
Well, let me go back to something.
Entanglement, all these are multidimensional concepts.
Okay,
go ahead.
Okay, let me go back to something specifically and concrete you said. You said, and we're basically out of time, so we got to try to finish this up. You basically said you would basically agree with me on this if you said if there was something else besides a mind or something like that. I was thinking, what else is there besides a mind, or if the mind was all there was or something like that?
Yeah, if the mind was all there was, then yes, we would be silicon machines, and would be no difference between a silicon machine and a meat machine, right?
So what else is there?
I'm saying there is a soul. I believe there is a soul, and I think that science is getting as close to
that. What does a soul have that a mind doesn't have?
Well, there are a lot of things a soul has that the mind doesn't have. A soul is who you are. It is your what's the word I'm looking for?
That's just an identity. It sounds like.
I think it's more than that. It's you can go back to the ancient philosophers, you know. But a soul is who you are. In other words, when your body, let's say your mind, gets diseased or old or something, you are still you. You are just unable to communicate through the. It's like being given a walkie-talkie or a phone that doesn't work.
That's what
you're
I think
still
doesn't.
There. You're just unable to communicate.
Well, that's what I think doesn't make sense. I mean, when a person has Alzheimer's, they go like, "Well, that's not the real him. The real him is a, he's gonna get the real him back in heaven when he dies or something." But it's like, no, that is the real you. When you have Alzheimer's, that's really you at that point. And when you were a toddler, that was you at that point. If you die as a toddler, there's no such thing as a real you.
Yeah, the toddler is different because the toddler is growing, so that mind, that soul has not matured. The soul has not grown. It has not. I mean, these are physical aspects that the soul has.
But there's no difference between a toddler that never had a soul and a person who's totally senile, doesn't know who he is, and he's already experienced life. There's no difference. They basically are points in time of what that person is.
Yeah, and this is where we are lacking in information. But it does not mean. All I'm saying is I'm giving you a plausible explanation. Now, if you're asking me to prove that somebody has a soul, I can't. I mean, we've been trying to do this for ages. But all I'm saying is that science tells us that there are multiple dimensions, and if there are multiple dimensions, it's quite feasible that there is intelligent existence in those dimensions, and if there's intelligent existence in those dimensions, then we've explained the soul. That's as simple as that is.
Okay, so we're out of time on that one. The next question is kind of on the same topic, so we might spill over into that.
No problem.
Okay, so this is about a YouTube video. It's only 2 minutes. If you want to look it up, it's called, quote, "Split Brain with One Half Atheist and One Half Theist," quote. And you've seen this before, right? Before our talk here.
Yeah.
So just to give an overview to the audience about this.
Now let's get to the neurology. And one group of patients we have studied is split brain patients or commiserotomy patients. These are people whose corpus callosum has been cut, and anterior commissure and massa intermedia whenever encountered. So essentially you're doing a karate chop right through the head and creating two human beings in one body, in one skull. Two spheres of consciousness. Now, many experiments have been done on these people, and I asked myself a very simple question. Okay, you've created two people here. What about their personalities? Do they have different personalities? What about their aesthetic preferences? Does one like blondes and the other like brunettes, for example? One like chocolate and the other like vanilla? What happens? So we tried these experiments, and what we did was we had to first train the right hemisphere to communicate with us. In fact, the right hemisphere can read simple commands, simple words, simple sentences. And then you ask a question and say, point to a box, yes, no, I don't know, because it can't talk. The right hemisphere cannot talk. But it can comprehend simple semantics, simple questions. Left hemisphere, of course, can talk, so you can present boxes, yes, no, I don't know. So we asked, for example, are you at Caltech? And the right hemisphere pointed to yes. Are you on the moon? It said no. Are you in California? It said yes. Are you asleep? It said no. Then I said, are you a woman? And the patient was male. And he pointed to yes, and then started chuckling and laughing. So at least the right hemisphere has a sense of humor. Okay, so now comes the big question. What if you ask, do you believe in God? So I said, do you believe in God? And the right hemisphere went straight to yes, right? Ask the same question to the left hemisphere, yes, no, I don't know. It went to no, right? So here's a human being whose right hemisphere is an atheist, and left hemisphere, on the other hand, believes in God. And this finding should have sent a tsunami through the theological community, but barely produced a ripple, because it raises all kinds of profound theological questions. If this person dies, what happens? Does one hem... Does one hemisphere go to heaven and the other go to hell? I don't know the answer to that.
But then they said, do you believe in God? And one part of the brain said yes, and the other part said no. And so the question there was, he ended the video with kind of laughter. Is like, what are theologians, how are they going to deal with this? Because is one part of the brain going to go to heaven and one part going to go to hell? What is this person? And so it shows the complexity of the brain and how difficult it is to say that, you know, there's some kind of a spiritual soul attached to this. I mean, how could this soul have some kind of state that's yes and no? So what are your thoughts on that?
Well, the corpus callosum was something that I was really fascinated about in college, and when I was at Oregon State University, no less, this was something that just totally fascinated me, and I spent a lot of time researching it, understanding it, and what you said is absolutely correct. What it is the corpus callosum connects the right hemisphere and the left hemisphere, and you could cut it, and you could show something to the right eye, and the left eye would not know it because there's no communication across. I mean, if you think of the best way to think of it is, you think of it a multiprocessor machine, where for some reason the memory cannot be shared between the two sides, the two processors. And so, of course, the two processors are going to be working on different concepts and different things. So the question was, obviously, as you said, they asked the person, you know, are you an atheist? And one side said yes, and the other side said no. I mean, first of all, is how many of them did they do? I mean, if they did one, it may have been just kind of a weird thing. Did they do 10? He doesn't talk about it. He only mentions one. But I think here's the issue. Given that here's where we fall back into the old thing. If there is such a thing as there is a soul, if there is a soul and it is interacting with the brain, then actually the brain is an atheist. The soul is the one that has the relationship with God. And I say atheist and theist because that is part of it, right? You know, he was saying, well, which side is going to go to hell? Is one side going to go to hell, the other one side going to heaven? And the body doesn't go to heaven or hell. It's a soul that goes to heaven or hell. So and this question has no meaning because you can't cut the soul in half. The soul is presumably a single solid entity in the multidimensional sphere that it is in. So therefore, the question is not, which part of the meat is going to go to hell, because all the meat is going to end up as worm food, right? I mean, that's all, we know that. All the organic matter is going to stay behind. So what ascends into relationship with God or out of relationship with God would be the more eternal part of it, and that would be the soul part of it. So I think that's how you answer the question.
Well, I mean, I don't really have a clear answer from you. I mean, you said, do you think the soul is attaching to a part of the brain, and so it only attaches the one part, not the other part?
Yeah, I would. Well, maybe not. See, that would be something that I would. Go back to my old days in college, and I would love to study that more and see if there is some way we can tie that in together. But just as I don't think that your salvation comes from your emotions, I don't think your salvation comes from your... you can logically get to the point where your soul understands and embraces. So let me go a step further here. One of the issues about logic is tying logic and reason to faith, and which is what I do all the time, is you can take someone so far logically to the point where it all makes sense that God rose from the dead and all that. But innately in them, they have a rejection of the facts. And I always say to some of my friends, I said, don't let the natural, the logical conclusions that you arrive at force you to abandon the logic.
I don't know. I would argue the opposite, that people are more predisposed to believe in God.
And it may too, because that's also bad, right? If you're predisposed to believe in God and it's the wrong God, or it's, you know, then you're again. So I would say,
I mean, the reason why I think is just because as creatures, you know, we're afraid of the dark and we believe in ghosts because, you know, something moved that bush over there and we didn't see what it was.
Maybe it was a ghost.
And yeah, I think I had a dream of somebody who departed. It must be ghosts. And so, I mean, that's why, right, I think it's more natural. And
but we agree on that. I think it takes the education to override that. I'm saying both of these are, in other words, if you believe in God because in spite of the logic, or you disbelieve in God in spite of the logic, you're still doing the wrong thing. Now, of course, for your listeners, I have not provided any evidence for either of this. You'd have to go read my book or listen to some of the previous debates that we've had. But so I'm not providing evidence in this. This is just a philosophical discussion here.
But wait, let me talk about something. You brought up this idea. It's like you said the brain is like a multiprocessor computer. And yeah, that's exactly what I agree with and what I'm trying to say. So, like, if you had a computer that had, let's say, 1,000 cores in it, it's all trying, let's say it's a learning computer, and it's trying to figure out what the world is all about, it's going to be crunching in unity to try to come up with an answer. And if you had half of those cores separated from the other half, now you have two computers, and the two computers are going to learn differently because they're looking at different inputs at different times. And so basically they're going to have a different answer. They're going to be at different states. And then if you chopped up those two to two more, so you had like four of them or eight or 16, all of these little computers, because they're learning from different stimuli and different results, they're all going to have a little different idea. And so basically we say, we built a mental image and we say this computer is basically the sum of all the parts. And of course, if you break it up, you're going to have two computers or three computers. So that's the idea with the brain. We say the brain, the mind arises from the brain. There is no one person's soul in there. So of course, if you chop it into two, you're going to have two different ideas. So it makes sense if the mind comes from the brain, you're going to get these different ideas with this kind of idea. But that's why I don't understand still, if there's one soul,
I'm trying to see the analogy is always difficult. The multidimensional analogy is the best one. Basically, yes, the computers are in three-dimensional space or four-dimensional space, and the soul or the controller of the computer is in multidimensional space, in the fifth-dimensional space, and it overrides all of that. So basically, you've got the computer and you've got the user. So the computer is your brain, the user is your soul.
No, I'm not talking about a user. Yeah, I'm talking about a self-learning.
Typing on the computer is the soul.
Okay, but I mean, but we need to talk about more advanced computers where they have self-learning computers where they can just start from scratch and observe the world and build up from what they observe and learn.
And I think that will happen, but I still don't think that makes them a soul. They're still a computer. They're still a machine, right? And we're back to this thing. I believe the user is the soul. The user is you. The computer is just the way you communicate with the world.
Well, they have robots now that will learn, like even learn how to walk. They don't even know how to walk, and they just try different things, and they learn how to walk.
Right, until they figure it out. Yeah, absolutely.
And they have all these kind of funny walking patterns because, it's good enough.
But all we've done is we've said, okay, so the computer now is more self-sufficient.
But there's also no user in it. It's just figuring it out. And then if you put two of these devices on the ground, they'd probably come up with a little different idea because they're just learning.
And that's what we call insects, right? The insect is the meat machine with no user, without no soul. Animals.
Well, it depends on what you say. I mean, some people say that all the animals also have souls. You know.
Well, so yeah, but I'm trying to give you an example. But most Christians say that the insects don't have souls, and of course the Hindus think they all have souls. So yeah, I don't want to get into that theological discussion, but I'm trying to give you an analogy here, yeah? So
I'll give you some, like, 30 seconds to try to summarize it then.
Okay. So the analogy here is the multiprocessor computer that is self-learning, the self-driving car, these are all the equivalent of insects or the equivalent of meat machines. And I'm saying human beings are given a soul by God uniquely and independently, and this is a multidimensional entity that science tells us does exist. And all I'm saying is there's an intelligent life and there's multiple dimensional existence, and your soul is in that multiple existence. And when you die, when your body dies, your soul continues, just like when the computer dies, I move to a new computer.
Yeah, I mean, like, one of the things, I got to ask you this, I guess, because it just doesn't make sense to me to say that God gives people souls. I mean, you know, if you know about the miscarriage rate, the natural miscarriage rate, it's so high, it's like, I don't know, it could be even as high as 80% or something. A lot of women have miscarriages without even knowing they're pregnant because it happens so early. Why is God giving souls to all these aborted babies?
The question you have to ask yourself is God giving a soul? Or is he assigning a soul or giving, you know, how? I don't know that there's no, the Bible doesn't really talk about that.
But why even assign a soul, or why even put a soul on something that's not even going to be born?
Well, because, remember, if you understand Christian theology, the reason why you're created is not for you to be on earth. The reason you're created is for you to enjoy God in all eternity in his presence. To glorify God in his presence. And for that, some people don't have to be on earth. They don't have to go through the earth.
Why not?
Part of it. Some people do.
Why not?
That's a good question. I think you could ask God, but I would say that the reason earth is similar to boot camp. We're being refined. Do we have free will in heaven? Yes, we better have free
But there's
will.
No boot camp
so
for anybody
get
that
to the point?
There's no boot camp for anybody that dies in a miscarriage before they're even born.
Perhaps because they didn't need it. That's my point.
Why would they not need it? You can't. It doesn't make sense to say, well, they would have turned out to be a perfect person because
Again, you're pushing the envelope, and I don't want to be. I'm not spouting this as theology. So
yeah,
listening to this. This is
I understand.
Not
yeah,
I'm saying these are possible answers. You know, I don't want somebody going, oh, well, Neil says. But here's okay. So there are multiple ways to look at it. One.
Well, we might actually.
God does not assign a soul. If God does not assign a soul, if the baby is not being viable, that's one possibility. The second one, he does assign a soul, but that soul does not need to come to earth to be refined, and that soul can go immediately into existence with him. And then you could say, well, why does he even have to go through that cycle, which is why that's a question. I mean, did you have to even be born? God could create a soul on his own to have a relationship with him. So these are good questions, and I think they are theological questions, but I don't think that the fact that we don't have an answer to them means that our solutions are wrong. Again, to your listeners, I'm not providing evidence here. This is a philosophical discussion.
Okay, so we might get more into that in a bonus material later, too. I have some more related questions on that. All right, ready for the next one?
Sure.
Okay, this is my question. Isn't the gospel nonsense? I mean, how does it make sense that God has to sacrifice himself? I mean, you know, God sacrifice his only son to appease his own wrath, and God and Jesus are the same God. But I mean, just even the whole idea of sacrifice, you know, just recently, well, I saw this just recently, but I guess it's been going on. In Brooklyn, for example, they have these Orthodox Jews that sacrifice chickens for their sins. Have you heard about this in the Bronx? I guess the Orthodox Jews.
No, I thought they were supposed to be lambs. I didn't realize.
Yeah, they basically this is for Yom Kippur celebrations. They basically get a chicken and they hold it by the wings, I guess, and they wave it around their head three times and, you know, ask for a blessing and for forgiveness of sins, basically putting the sins on that chicken. And there's you know, people saying this is cruelty to animals, and so there's been lawsuits over it. And I think last year they had a lawsuit over it, and I think they maintained the right because they said it's not hurting anybody. And it's, you know, the Orthodox Jews, some of them are saying this is something we've been doing for 2,000 years.
Are you chickens and not pigeons or doves?
Yeah, they're chickens.
It just seems out of context, because in the Bible they talk about doves, they talk about lambs, they talk about cows, but I don't remember chickens. Okay.
Well, at this point, I'm going to show a clip from a video. Okay, the video basically shows these protesters, and they're all protesting because these guys have, I mean, there's crates and crates of chickens that are doing this. It's a big thing. And then they also kind of leave a mess when they go. They're kind of sloppy rabbis, I guess, or something. I don't know, or people. They leave a mess behind, and they show this truck driving off, and there's some dead chickens on the street, and they're just crunching over the bones. And So some people say that they're making a mess too, and all this. But anyway, there's really upset. I irate people because it looks like animal cruelty what they're doing here, just because there's so many chickens involved and just such a mess, I guess.
So the barricades have been set up, and the police are here to protect the people who are slaughtering the chickens from those of us who are actually trying to protect them.
You're depriving chicks of food and water. Stop the world. Chicken slaughter.
Each year before Yom Kippur, tens of thousands of ultra-Orthodox Jews around the world swing chickens around their heads in a ritual to transfer their sins to the animals, who they then slaughter and dump in the garbage. In Brooklyn, an army of activists clashed in the streets with the perpetrators.
You're killing.
You're harassing.
And police officers struggled to control the chaos.
Get out of the street right now. Go after the Muslims. They're cutting off heads.
What about the 50,000 heads being chopped off right here?
We have a tradition to do this for thousands of years. We're not stopping it because PETA protesters tell us that it's suffering for the chickens. We can't use money because you're torturing money, torturing paper.
This is not what God would want.
What do you have to hide here?
I never saw you in a demonstration against people killing every day thousands of people.
So this justifies this?
No, it means that you are anti-Semitic. Good night. Yep.
You're worried about a chicken, and you don't care about abortion.
So ignorant. So ignorant.
Hold on, Anti-Semites, demonstrate against ISIS. Demonstrate against ISIS, you.
Go to ISIS, they care that way.
So go to McDonald's, happens every day.
Go to the big corporate people who are not religious, they're going to buy your crap. Go there.
We're going to keep coming back year after year until the massacre stops.
Sick in the head. Sick in the head.
There's a Chinese restaurant. They have delicious chicken. You guys should go over, check it out.
Get a job, loser. Loser, get a job, loser.
You'd rather kill a person over an animal.
Why would you have to make that choice?
Why? I do.
Which Holocaust? The one against the Jews, against my relatives, or the one here tonight?
Good morning.
Get out of our neighborhood.
Stop the massacre and we'll be gone.
Get the fuck out of my way.
They were put into this world for a reason.
No, we brought them into this world. We bred them in factories.
God made everything for a purpose. God tell us to do something.
Chickens are stupid and I don't respect them. That's right. I don't respect them.
Does the fact that they're stupid, if that's what you think they are, mean that they don't feel hunger and thirst?
Not to a certain extent.
What does that mean?
It doesn't mean a lot.
Don't
you
feel
came pain? Out here today for chickens. You are such a loser, my friend.
They were created for us.
So do you think God meant for these chickens to be stuffed into crates for several days at a time with no food and water?
Exactly.
Fertilization. You God think that they want to be
eaten? No, I don't want to be eaten. No.
I love to kill the chicken. I love to kill the chicken. Yeah, baby.
Love you.
Excuse me, you're hurting that chicken. Their wings are very fragile.
I'm here speaking out for these animals that are being tortured.
Why would you do that to someone else? Would you like that to be done to you? Your arms behind your back? You have your throat slit?
You can use money instead of chickens, and you choose to use chickens.
And you know full well,
for what
you
reason?
Know full well, phone, and you choose to use smartphone. Use money, not chickens.
Not chickens.
That bird is feeling pain right now. How dare you torture that bird? That's evil. You're murdering babies. There's no mitzvah here.
You're just accruing more sin. You're not getting rid of any sin. Like killing other animals, you cowards.
Thou shalt not kill. Did you not learn that?
Who's responsible for the chickens?
Probably the health department, not me.
But how could they not be here? You're not allowed to have slaughterhouses in the streets.
Listen to me.
It's illegal.
I'm a police officer.
So much for kosher slaughter. There are chickens writhing in agony in those bags.
This is the mitzvah for the Jewish.
Make this your last bloodbath! Make this your last bloodbath! Make this your last bloodbath!
How cruel is it to make them starve in those crates? They can't even spread a wing.
This world was not created for humans alone. This world was created for all of the creatures that are on it.
It's my job to make sure everybody's safe.
Of course the chickens aren't safe because they're being massacred.
Fine, that's fine.
You don't want people to see what's going on back there?
Come! Slice a chicken's throat! You're gonna atone for cheating on your wives by slicing a chicken's throat! God will forgive you!
Money goes to charity! Chickens go in the garbage! Money goes to charity! Chickens go in the garbage! Money goes to charity! Chickens go in the garbage! We see you! We care! We're sorry! We're trying! We see you! We care! We're sorry! We're trying! We see you! We care! We're sorry! We're trying!
Do me a favor, can you just stay in one group? We're going to set up one area for you guys. Right?
That would make our protest convenient.
Yeah, I want to be organized.
We're not looking to be convenient.
Depriving chicks of food and water. Ban Caporos, chicken slaughter.
No. No, you don't get
it. I'm allowed to be here. It's a public sidewalk.
No, you don't.
There's a massacre going on. We need to disrupt it.
You cannot interfere with a religious.
But I can be on a public street.
No, but you're not allowed to take a video.
You're not allowed to torture animals.
Excuse me. The pen is right there.
You are killing.
You touched me. Why are you touching me? It's against your religion. Videotaping you.
I believe that all humans and sentient beings deserve respect.
We'll be back. We'll be back. We'll be back. We'll be back.
I'm in here, a prisoner of history. Can anybody help?
So the bottom line is there is an outcry in the general public because it's like, what is this barbaric thing you're doing with the chickens? You're being cruel to them, you're killing them, and this whole thing about sacrifice. I mean, you know, the Aztecs were big on sacrifice also. There's rumors actually that this Aztecs at one time sacrificed like 80,000 people in over a period of 3 days. And some people are saying, well, these just might be rumors. I mean, maybe that was their enemies trying to overstate
that's too many Spaniards or whatever. Were there that many Aztecs to begin with? I mean,
well, there's supposedly like over 200,000, but sometimes they'd go out and get their enemies and sacrifice them. And I think I heard too maybe they sacrificed them to make sure the sun came up the next day. But in general, there's this idea in religion that you need to sacrifice something to appease the angry gods, like throw the woman virgin into the volcano. And so I'm going to give you some time to talk about how does this whole idea of sacrifice make sense. And one more thing. Do you know about the Christian musician? His name was Keith Green.
Yeah.
He's the guy, when I was a Christian, I really loved his music and everything. And he wrote an article one time about how, you know, the gospel really is a bloody thing. And a lot of Christians don't want to talk about it because it just sounds icky. But, you know, when you read the Old Testament, they used to sprinkle blood all over the altar and sprinkle it, you know, basically all over the place. And it was a real big bloody mess. And, you know, he was saying as Christians, we shouldn't be afraid to preach the blood. And so that's another aspect of this, you know. So I'm going to give you some time to talk about this.
Yeah, let me start by, you know, we got to go back to the foundations of Christian theology. Christian theology says that God gave mankind free will to choose between a relationship with God or to do his own thing or to part ways with God. So as a result of giving you free will, God has to genuinely give you free will. He can't say, look, you can go anywhere in the house, but the doors are all locked. You can't do that, right? I mean, if he's going to give you free will, then he has to give you free will. Secondly, the free will must include the freedom to do things that are bad. And the reason something is bad is because it hurts people. It's going to hurt somebody. It's going to kill somebody. Otherwise, it wouldn't be bad. The very definition of bad is that it's going to hurt somebody. So God has to allow people to actually, if God said, look, you have free will to do anything, but the minute you try to hurt somebody, I'm going to stop you. Well, then you never really had the free will to hurt anybody. You never had the free will to disobey God, right? You've got to actually have the ability to disobey God, and it's got to have consequences of why God would tell you not to do something. So God says, don't do something. There should be a real reason why you shouldn't do it. So all that to say that mankind chose to disobey God. But now, let's say you have a sister and your sister gets raped, and you take your sister, and you cast the guy who raped your sister and you take him to the judge. And the judge says, I am a kind and loving judge. So, Mr. Rapist, I'm going to forgive you. You can go free. Well, is that a good judge? No, that's an evil judge. So, therefore, if God is going to be a good and just God, he has to punish the sin. So, when you do these bad things, which is really rebellion against God, God has to punish that. But here's the problem. God has a dilemma. Here's the dilemma that he has. He's an all-loving God. But if he forgives you, then he's not a good judge. He's not justice. But if he punishes you, then his love is compromised, right? So he's got this problem. Does he punish you? And by the way, the punishment is eternal separation from God. That's basically what you're saying. If you rebel against God, you're saying, I don't want to be with God anymore. So God says, look, here's my dilemma. I can punish you, which means you're separated from me forever, or I can love you, but I can't. But I gotta punish you at the same time. So his solution is like the, and you, I'm sure you've heard this example. A kid comes in front of the judge, and they say, look, he has been speeding down here. He has to pay a fine of $500. And the judge says, oh my gosh, this is my son, right? Well, does the judge forgive the son? No, he can't forgive the son because he'd be a bad judge. So what the judge does, he gets down, he says, look, I'm going to pay the fine myself. So I will pay the fine. Justice will be met. So God says, I will pay the fine. I will meet the justice. So God's love is met because he's loved you, and he's loved you by sacrificing himself, and God's justice has been met. It's been met by him paying the price. So therefore, you've got the whole thing. But guess what? The guy who you and me, we can't, there are two parts to being justified. One is you have to ask for forgiveness. You can't just go and say, well, fine, judge, you pay the price. I don't care. No, you've got to actually ask for forgiveness. So that's number one. And two, you have to accept the price, the forgiveness that God gives you. And if you think about this, this logically makes sense. There is no other way that this would work. God can't come in here and say, look, I forgive everybody. And at the same time, he can't come in and say, I take away all your free will.
Well, I disagree. Right? It logically makes sense. That's why I'm talking about the whole question here. I don't think it makes sense, logically.
How else would you do this? I always like to turn the question around and say, okay, you come up with a solution for this problem. You want people to have free will. One of their free will's ways is to do really violent things and hurt people.
Okay, well, let's start with that, the free will thing. You're saying people have to have free will. One of the problems with that defense for a Christian such as yourself is that it contradicts the Bible, because the Bible in Romans 9, it talks about how God can harden who he wants to harden. In other words, let me finish. It says, you know, you can say like, well, that's not fair. And he says, wait, hey, you can't tell the potter what kind of pots he can make. He can make things whatever he wants to. So that verse right there just blows out the whole free will defense, because it's not important to God.
No. Okay, let me answer that one. First of all, Adam and Eve truly had free will. And let me explain what that verse says. That verse says God can do that. But if God is a loving judge, a loving God, then he's not going to do that. But here's the second part of it.
Well, wait, yes. It doesn't say he can. It doesn't say he can do it. It says he did do that. He gave Pharaoh as an example.
He has a right to do it. No. Well, let me finish that. Secondly, by the way, just for clarification, I am a Calvinist, okay? So I do believe in predestination. So let me go a step further. However, even with Reformed theology, which is Calvinism, we believe fully that Adam had free will. Adam had total free will. What we are doing, the reason that God steps in to save us is because we have been so corrupted by Adam's sin, by our sin nature that we've inherited from him, that we are now unable to meet God. But
that's
that does
a,
not
okay.
remove... Let me go a step further.
Well, that's
that
just a different...
That does
not remove
sanctification, though.
I just wanted to... Sure. I mean, just going back to the free will thing, you have a major point that God creates creatures and it's very important to him that they have free will, and that is a philosophical idea. If you want to have a philosophical God that you create, you can come up with that. That makes sense, but that's not the Christian God. That's not the Christian Bible teaching that.
The Bible is very clear that Adam had free will, had 100% free will.
Pharaoh didn't have free will,
the
and God.
God only applies.
You know
to,
what? Why? Hey.
Only applies to the God who saved.
Why can't God? Is it possible that God could say, hey, I'm going to make you right now, I'm going to make you go kill some people? Could God do that?
But that would not give you free will. That would not be free will. I believe that we actually have free will in our daily life.
I know, but
don't confuse justification with sanctification.
No, but what I'm saying is, God can do whatever he wants to people, and then people might, according to the Bible, God can do whatever he wants, and if you say, well, that's not fair, God would never do that. The reply from Romans 9 is that you are the pot, not the potter. The potter can do whatever he wants to.
But
you are in no place to judge him.
Yes.
So therefore, it basically is very clear that free will is not important to God.
Remember, the line says, what if God?
It doesn't. Well, it's trying to give the motivation.
It says,
no, that was for the motivation. I was saying, what if God did this because he's trying to show his love or something? So basically, he's trying to justify why God would override somebody's free will.
We've got to go back to Adam. Adam had 100% free will. He chose the wrong thing. As a consequence, we have all these things. So Christ's punishment is in fact, ignore the rest of the world. Just look at Adam, right?
Well, I don't believe in. I don't believe there was an Adam.
Adam.
I don't believe there was a first
God
human.
Adam,
so.
Okay, because when we start bringing the Reformed theology, it really is. You have to understand it's applicable to those who came after Adam. It is applicable to those who have sinned and rejected God post Adam, right? Mm.
Yeah,
Adam
well,
had free will, 100% free will.
Right.
So let's deal with Adam. What does God do about Adam?
Yeah, we have a problem at the root there because I don't believe in an Adam. I don't believe in a first human.
Okay,
but since,
well, of course you do.
But you don't.
But
you don't,
you're posing the question.
No, I don't believe in Adam. I don't believe in a first human.
I know you don't. But you're posing the question as though Adam existed, right? You're saying why does this not? You're saying this does not make sense. Well, if Adam existed, then this would make sense. So you'd have to show if Adam existed.
I was trying to say your free will defense does not work because the Bible teaches against it. Has nothing to do with Adam. It has to do with what the Bible teaches about God and free will in Romans 9.
The definition only applies to those who came after Adam. It does not apply to Adam.
Okay,
nothing in Reformed theology says that it applies to Adam or Eve, for that matter.
Okay, well, one other thing I just wanted to mention, too, is that you're saying that justice demands that you punish somebody, and so God was punished in our stead instead of us.
Yeah.
But I would say that's actually an injustice. If somebody pays the penalty for somebody else, that's injustice. In other words, raped somebody and he said, okay, well, the price for that is we're going to torture your dad instead of you, I mean, that would be a miscarriage of justice, I think.
No, if you have to go back to the ancient ways where it was acceptable for someone, the justice is when the price is paid, and the person. So again, remember, if the rapist says, "Look, yes, I did the rape, but I am really sorry. I will never do it again, and God knows if you have or have not done, will not do it again." Now the forgiveness has been asked for. Now the price has to be paid. The penalty has to be paid.
Okay.
Right. Because again, if you think about it, it serves no purpose. Once the rapist has fully confessed, is really sorry for it, the going and killing the rapist is not going to gain you anything.
But it's even worse.
Right? But the price still has to be paid.
It's even worse
still has to be paid.
It's even worse when an innocent person has to pay the price. That's a miscarriage of justice.
No, but that's a choice that they make. God is the one. God is the judge here, and he is the paying the price. So it's not an innocent person. It's the person who is the ruler of all the world. He's the creator of everything. It's not like I'm picking some schmo off the street and saying, hey, you pay the price. No, it's the guy who is choosing to pay the price is also the judge. The judge is paying the price. Okay. It changes the dynamic there. The judge is the one paying the price. The judge saying the price has to be paid, and the judge is saying I'm paying the price.
Okay. How about if we leave it there and move on to the next one, because we went over time on that? Okay. So the next one is, these last two are just going to be 6.5 minutes because we're going low on time here.
Okay.
What would it take?
They might be quick.
What's that?
These might be quick.
I can go on hours for each one of these, I think. Anyway, what would it take for you, Neil, to stop believing in the existence of God? You know, because we both agree that we're coming to our decisions based on logic. Whatever reason you want to give, what would it take for you to stop believing that God exists?
There are a few reasons. It's quite easy. Well, first of all, there's a difference between believing in God and believing in Jesus Christ, so being a Christian and being a theist. So let me answer the being a theist one. Being the theist, the easiest way to prove that I should not believe in God is if things started popping out of existence out of nothing. That's number one. Number two is if there were infinite universes, if you could prove that there are infinite universes. Because obviously can't prove there is no God, right? But if you're able to prove that there are infinite universes, I would. Or if you're able to create that the things popped out of nothing, or you were able to prove the universe has existed forever. These are the three things.
So basically you're saying you need to understand how the universe was created, otherwise you're going to believe in God? That's a huge mystery, and until that mystery is resolved, you're going to believe in God?
No, because if you read my book, you'll see that I have philosophically and logically eliminated all possibilities of the universe being created by itself. That means it needs a. In fact, the book goes very carefully into it needs a creator that is intelligent, all powerful, omnipresent, omnipotent, omniscient. And also, it needs a creator that is personal.
Okay, so God
has a free will.
So God is all powerful. He's a personal. He's a mind without a brain. He's a mind, a consciousness without any kind of physical body whatsoever.
If you think about it, he has to be, because if the universe is time, matter, and energy, at the point of the Big Bang, time, matter, and energy began to exist. Therefore, whatever created the universe has to be not constrained by time, matter, and energy. Otherwise, how did it?
I think the multiverse theory could be appropriate.
That's why I said, if you can come up with infinite universes, I would stop believing in God.
Not infinite universes, I said a multiverse.
No, it has to be infinite. Multiverse is not sufficient.
I don't think you need to appeal to infinity.
Multiverse won't explain the fine-tuning of the Big Bang, the cosmological constants, and all that stuff. I mean, again, I go through this in the book. There are like 39 different
nothing explains the fine
things.
Nothing explains the fine tuning, because these are all the things that are outside our grasp scientifically. These are what they call God of the gaps arguments.
No, because these are philosophical concepts. I mean, if you say, look, the universe has these constants that have no reason, and they
but
agree.
We don't know. We don't know if they have these constants.
Physicists agree that there's no good reason for these constants to be there.
They're not saying.
Oh, well, yeah, there could be some reason for them. No, they're saying there is no good reason for these.
No, you know what?
If you look at Davies or even Hawking, he says there is no good reason for these.
It doesn't matter who you read. It's the how the universe came to be. We are so infantile in our understanding of the cosmos that we cannot comprehend it yet. So it doesn't matter who you appeal to.
But
I mean,
that's
like
simply
if,
not
let,
true.
Well, let me finish. Let me finish. If you went back like 100 years ago, somebody might talk about space and time such as if they're different things. And when Einstein came along, he said, no, the space and time is one thing. It's like a fabric that can be bent by gravity. So right when he came with that, everything that was previously thought about space and time got totally thrown out the window. So it doesn't matter what kind of philosophy you had before that, everything you know about space and time totally got thrown out the window.
Okay.
And
okay,
so in the same way, there are so many things we don't understand about the other dimensions and all that, that it's crazy to say, like, well, there's these fine-tuning things, And if you can't explain them, then God exists. Because why? Because magic?
No. I didn't jump to God exists. All I'm saying that whatever it does not allow you to explain the fine tuning unless you have infinite universes. Having 10 universes does not explain the fine tuning.
The fine tuning is
100 universes doesn't explain the fine tuning. To get the fine tuning, you'd need at least a few. You need an infinite universe. Mm-hmm. You need every single possible variation of the universe to exist. And we just so happen to be amazingly on that just one that worked, right?
Well,
or those few that worked, right?
Well, Vic Stenger is a guy who died, but he wrote a book about God, the failed hypothesis. And a couple of things mm-hmm. he said is, number one, we don't even know if these are fine tuning or not, because, you know, for example, sometimes they give all these fine-tuning constants, and sometimes they're related, like this one, like A and B, but actually A and B is all part of C, so it's just one thing. And we don't even really know if these are...
So let me rephrase that. At the current state of science, we think that there are no relationships to fine-tuning, and I accept science the way it is. So if you want to wait for something new to appear, I'm fine with that, but I am going with the current state. I'm not going to hope for the hope for the hope, because then you might as well hope some more and see if things change after that.
Well,
I'm going with science the way it is right now.
Well, yes. The other thing is you said if something could come from nothing, then that would impress you?
Yeah, yeah.
Well, and then you've heard about the virtual particles, haven't you, about how there's... particles that pop into existence and antiparticles, and they usually annihilate each other.
They're not coming out of nothing.
They're coming out of no material.
They're just changing state. They're not actually creating out of nothing.
Here's one way to explain it. Like, let's say, for example, you have a vacuum. You have a place that has a vacuum. There's nothing material in there. Mm-hmm. They say there's no such thing as nothing in that case, because if you could have a huge vacuum with nothing in it, you're going to get these particles that are popping in and out of existence, these virtual particles, and over time, it's a lopsided equation, and so matter does come into existence.
I think you're reading that incorrectly. There's actually no scientific theory right now that allows for things to appear out of nothing. If you have wave particles, if you have wave functions and all that, though, that is something. Nothing really is nothing.
But it's nothing. Right? No, but the idea is it's nothing.
And they've never had something come out of nothing. Well,
the idea that it's
that.
But the idea, I agree with you that there's the fields and all that. But the idea is that it is impossible to have a pure vacuum, because there's quantum foam, and from that quantum foam arises these particles and antiparticles.
So within our universe, yes. Within our universe, it is quite possible that you can never have nothing. I totally agree, because our universe is something. But that is the dilemma, isn't it? Because the universe came from nothing. So if the universe came from nothing...
I don't think it came from nothing. I think it came from something else, like the multiverse theory.
If it came from something mm-hmm. else, then that something else has to be either have a free will,
no,
or there has to be an infinite number of them. And there you go. Because basically you can't have a non-mechanistic cause. The problem with a non-mechanistic cause is a non-mechanistic cause can do something once, or it can do something over and over again.
If it did
something once, then we're back to time. We have a problem with time, because if it did something once, then it would have created the universe eternity ago. But the universe is not eternally old.
Okay.
So therefore, it would have to do something over and over again, in which case it would have to be infinite universes. So these are the two conditions.
All right. Well, we're out of time again on this one. I only have 5 minutes here for my last one here.
Go ahead.
So this question is...
What would it take for me to start believing in God?
Okay. Yeah, what would it take for me to start believing in the existence of God? And what I would say is, you know, I was a Christian. I believed in God. I felt like I had the presence of God. I was led by God. And I would have remained a Christian, I tell people, that if I would have... I really felt like if I could just find a thread of logic or reason or evidence or anything to believe in God, I would, because I really wanted to believe in God. But I could not even find a thread. And so basically, I would say some really good evidence is what would convince me. I don't think there's any good evidence for the existence of God. So what evidence is there to convince me that God exists?
Well, I think you've seen it, and I think here's the question.
I mean, like, for example, let me just tell you one. For example, you said the fine tuning. We talked about fine tuning. You said if you could explain fine tuning. As far as I'm concerned, fine tuning is a God of the gaps argument. It's something that we don't know, and you're saying, well, you can't explain it, therefore God did it. You can't explain fine tuning, therefore God did it.
No. What I said was fine tuning is just one of the arguments. There are seven arguments in the book. That's just one of them. It's like when you're looking for a murderer, you have seven, you know.
But the thing
hair.
Is, they all, okay, I
well,
think they all stem.
And then he has a scar. Well, a lot of people have a scar and a red hair. And
but I think they all stem.
You keep fine tuning it.
But I think they all stem from the same logical fallacies. A lot of them are the argument from ignorance, dressed up in
and
a tuxedo,
I don't
you know.
Think that is. I think a lot of it is. So the real question I would ask Bernie is, why do you not want there to be a God?
I want there to be a God because I would love to live for eternal life. I would love not to have to deal with my own mortality. I have to be intellectually courageous to accept my mortality now.
Yeah,
I was in denial.
I don't know. I mean, is there something deep inside you that says, you know what, if there is a God, the problem of there being a God is that he's going to expect me to praise and glorify him.
Wait. Can you restate that, because your phone cut out, so either the devil or God was trying to stop that message from coming through. So can you repeat that? You never know if it's God or the devil. You know, it's always one of them. They're trying to stop things around here.
Maybe God is making sure you aren't predestined to something. Yeah, I know. Okay, let's not get into Reformed theology.
Maybe the devil is trying to hold you back, or else God's trying to keep me from listening. So,
I mean, as a good Calvinist would say, maybe, yeah. No, my question was, is there something in you that you would not want to glorify God for all eternity?
Like I said, I want to believe in God.
Is there something about God you don't like that you would refuse to glorify him? I mean, because obviously there are things. I mean, again, when I say God, I don't mean just some nebulous God. I mean the actual God of the Bible, the guy described in the Bible, the guy that, you know, required these chicken sacrifices. I mean, not that I think he required those chicken sacrifices, but he did require lamb sacrifices. He did require, I mean, those were all for symbolic reasons. And then he did require a blood sacrifice, his own son.
Is there something
in it that turns against
him?
No,
I love the idea that Jesus bore the punishment for me, that I could believe in Jesus, that he took the sins for me. I can be really close to God. I had a love relationship with Jesus, which I think is a delusion now. But I felt like I had a love relationship. I was very much in love with God, very close to God. But I think it's all a delusion.
Yeah. I mean, I find that interesting. I wish it weren't true, obviously, because I like you very much. But you know, it at the end of the day, though, I've talked to a lot of friends of mine who are atheists. I'm surrounded by atheists, and we go to lunch all the time. We have great discussions. They're very good friends of mine. A lot of times, they're like, you know, at the end of the day, I admit, I just don't like the whole idea of, you know, bowing down to this God or losing my independence or whatever. I mean, there's something, or I don't like those rules and regulations. And despite the fact that I explained, well, those rules and regulations are there to protect you, not to make you have a miserable life, but to protect you and keep you from having a miserable life. And none of those rules are for God. They're all for your safety.
I mean, that's not my case. I mean, there's a lot of different atheists, just like there's a lot of different Christians. You know, you argue with a lot of different Christians over theology and stuff. I do the same with atheists. So that's one reason why I do this show, is because I kind of want to show a different perspective so they don't think all atheists are like Hitchens or Dawkins. And I like some of what all these guys do, but there's different flavors out there. Well, we're out of time. I'd like to give you like a 20-second summary.
Yeah, I think I think to summarize my statement, I believe that while I can't prove it right now, I think science will be able to prove it shortly, that there is a multidimensional existence, and that multidimensional existence is like a two-dimensional creature trying to interact with a three-dimensional creature. And I think our soul is in that multidimensional plane. So that would explain a lot of what we've been seeing. And I do believe that the gospel is logical when it comes to justice and payment of Christ's sacrifice.
All right. Well, thanks for being on the show. I appreciate it.
Thank you very much. Thanks for having me.
Okay, Neil. In March, on March 11th, coming up, 2016, in case you're watching this as an old rerun, there, Biola University has these Christian apologists. They're defenders of the faith, traveling around the country, and they're coming to Eugene, which is not far from where I live in Portland area. And so we have three of them coming here, Craig Hazen, J.P. Moreland, and Clay Jones. And I'm going to set up a presentation at a nearby place before they come into town on the same day, just a couple hours before that, if people want to come to it. And I'm basically going to say how I debunk what they are saying. And they have three different, they're going to be talking about the evidence for the resurrection, why does God permit evil, and what is the evidences for God's existence. So anyway, in studying for that, I looked up what some of these people are saying and what they believe, and Dr. Craig Hazen, for example, was in a short video. It's 2 minutes long. It's called What Distinguishes Christianity from Other Faiths, and I'll play a clip of that right now.
Dr. Hazen, we're living in a time where a lot of people are confused about Christianity or other faiths for that matter. I mean, they'll say, what distinguishes Christianity from other faiths? When you look at other faiths, they'll claim miracles, they'll claim healings, they'll believe that God leads them by providence, they'll say that God answers their prayers, they have special revelation. So how do we really feel confident as Christians that we've got the right truth?
You know, we actually use the mind that God has given us to explore these claims. And it's not that hard. In fact, one thing I've discovered is people of other faiths and even religious studies experts and experts in world religions hate the idea of actually probing those claims. You see? In other words, if a Buddhist makes a claim or a Hindu or a Muslim makes a claim, you know, or a Mormon, for goodness sakes, don't probe the claim. I don't investigate it, because you'll be disappointed, or it's not going to give you the answer you're hoping for, or it really can't be probed because it's so mystical and otherworldly. Christianity is very different in that it invites investigation. It says, come and explore this and see if you can understand. And again, Paul in 1 Corinthians 15 makes this outrageous statement. If Jesus did not come back from the dead, Christianity is just not true. Your faith is worthless. Go do something else, for goodness sakes. There's no other religion that takes the probing and the investigation so seriously. Christianity can withstand that kind of investigation. Other religions just simply can't.
Okay, so as I summarize that clip, basically the question that was given to him was, what distinguishes Christianity from all the other faiths? And he even mentioned that, you know, a lot of the faiths claim divine revelation and they have miracle healings and stuff like that. So from what I saw, Craig's answer was, number one, that Christians use the mind. And he said that other faiths hate the idea of probing claims. But he said basically Christianity can withstand the investigation. That's what he left on his message. That's how he left the message, basically. That was a summarization that Christianity does invite investigation, and it can take the investigation. It can withstand it. And then he also brought up that if Jesus didn't rise, then Christianity is all worthless, as if that was, I'm not sure what that had to do with his point. So basically, I wanted to bring up one thing here. He basically said all the other faiths hate to be probed. They hate to be questioned. One thing, I'll just do a quote here from the Dalai Lama, for example, which I think rebukes this idea. The Dalai Lama, who's a Tibetan Buddhism representative, he said, quote, if scientific analysis were conclusively to demonstrate certain claims in Buddhism to be false, then we must accept the findings of science and abandon those claims. So that's a very pro-scientific stance, I think, which I think is admirable. He's basically saying, if we believe anything that goes against science, go with the science. We'll change our beliefs. You're not going to find us contradicting science. Whereas, for example, your faith, Neil, you personally, you reject modern science as far as biological evolution. So I think the Dalai Lama here would say, yes, of course we believe in evolution, that humans evolved from other animals. What are your views on all this?
I mean, obviously, I think Craig, I think he's right in many ways, but with Buddhism, and one thing you have to understand, Buddhism is basically atheistic philosophy. I mean, the Siddhartha Gautama never really said that there was a God. He just talked about reincarnation, which, by the way, is not the same reincarnation as in Hindu reincarnation. It's a slightly different modified form of it. But, I mean, if you think about it, Buddhism really isn't scientific in that sense either, because, I mean, how can you prove reincarnation? How can you prove, I mean, you don't believe in reincarnation.
Well, my understanding is that in Buddhism there's a lot of different strands. I mean, some are actually hardcore atheists where there's no afterlife, and then some of them get into worshiping God, you know, the Buddha is a God. And there's a huge range in there.
Yeah, some of them are modified Hinduism. I mean, when Buddhism got to India, it kind of, Buddha became a god, or one of the gods, right? Instead of just an enlightened being and so stuff like that. But Buddhism, basically, except for the atheistic parts of it, but the Dalai Lama himself does believe in a dharma and karma, you know, the whole idea that you will pay reap the consequences of your sins, things like that. So I would say that the Dalai Lama is a bad example for this, but there are Buddhist atheists who may be a better example. But I think when Craig was talking about it, he was talking about the traditional standard mainline religions, and I think Buddhism is not scientific in that sense. Now, Christianity is not scientific in the sense of evolution, but we believe that we can actually prove that evolution—that there is no, not sufficient evidence for macroevolution. And I hate getting into arguments about evolution, just because every time I become an expert on something, there'll be a new discovery, and then I got to go become an expert on that. So a long time ago,
you can't say Christians are against evolution, because some are very pro-evolution
theistic,
and some are against it, right?
Francis Collins is a theistic evolutionist. I believe that. I disagree with Francis Collins on that. I mean, he's a great guy, but I think that there's some theological issues with that, because Christianity does depend on the existence of a real Adam who did sin, not some sort of gradual refining of the mind and on self-awareness that way. So I don't disagree with Hagism, because if you look at of Islam definitely is a very feelings-oriented religion. If you look at Hinduism, definitely very feelings-oriented religion, and there's, you know, again, reincarnation, caste system, and all that stuff. Not that the caste system really has much to do with science, but you get the point. So I think he's talking about the major religions. So I would agree with him in most cases.
But it seems like there's a lot of feelings in Christianity, too. For example, William Lane Craig, says, you know, me personally, I feel the presence of Jesus, and that's how I know God's alive, and I'm an atheist, but when I was a Christian, I would say I felt the presence of Jesus too, but I think it's a delusion.
I would say that there are some people who go that step. I don't, you know, because I know that I may feel the presence of Jesus, but it could be the pizza I ate yesterday, you know, it could be the oxytocin flooding my system, right? There's so many other things. In fact, one of the things that I'm going to be putting in my book, the No Blind Faith book, is that you can actually sit in a lab, and they can probe your brain, put electrodes in your brain, and you will actually feel that you're in the presence of God. You will actually have this euphoric feeling that God is now communicating with you, just because of some electricity being sent through a certain part of your brain.
Well, you know what? It's kind of funny.
And I would say that does not mean that God really is there. So therefore, if you are going to look for that, you better look for real answers, real solid logic. And if you look at the Old Testament, whenever God did a miracle, they were not supernatural miracles that only exist in the supernatural plane, but they were supernatural miracles that had real-world physical mass, energy, and time consequences.
Well,
and that's what we're looking for.
So, you know, you're talking about this God helmet, right?
Yeah.
So this God helmet, basically, for people who don't know, the researchers put this helmet on subjects, and basically it stimulates a part of their brain and they feel like they're having an experience with God. You know, it's kind of funny because, you know, a lot of atheists probably would say, like, see, that's right there evidence that, you know, God's not real. It's just a trick on your mind. And it's kind of interesting that you are also giving it credit. You know, it's kind of funny, as an atheist and a former Christian, I kind of tend toward to be more skeptical. I mean, I would like to try it myself and see, but you know, like sometimes Christians say, hey, I feel God just like I can feel the presence of my wife, or I have a relationship with God like a relationship with my wife. That's how I kind of feel about it, and I'm skeptical that you could actually get a feeling from a helmet. And also, you know, this helmet, I think there's a story about, you know, that they put this on Richard Dawkins, and Richard Dawkins was like, well, you know, it didn't do anything for me. It's, you know, maybe, maybe I'm beyond hope, you know, because I didn't feel anything. But and then you got some atheists like Dan Barker, who used to be a fundamentalist preacher, and he goes, hey, you know, I used to speak in tongues, and I can still speak in tongues if I wanted to, but I don't believe in God, obviously. So there's a lot of funny anecdotes.
And this is why I keep reemphasizing that, you know, if we Christians are going to have faith, it better be based on facts and logic and real-world consequences, and not just feelings.
You know, it's kind of interesting because he said, you know, investigate Christianity because it can withstand the investigation. And, you know, that's not my experience at all. Like, especially if you go to a big church, if you try to talk about evolution, I agree with you, it causes a lot of problem for theology. And that's one reason why I left the faith. But a lot of churches, you know, they don't want to talk about it because it's so divisive. It's like, don't even go there and ask questions about this. Let's not argue about this. So when he says it can withstand the investigation, I kind of get a different feeling about that. I don't see them being upfront about all the issues and willing to discuss them and things like that.
Again, I think you should differentiate what the popular culture is of Christianity and what the philosophical consequence of Christianity is. I mean, I think, you know, a lot of people are seven-day creationists. Well, I'm not, right? But that doesn't mean that I think that if you, you know, that's why if you go have a debate with, you know, Ken Ham or someone, I'm going to think you'll win. But in the same way, if you go and have a debate with Hugh Roth, I think that you'll be, you know, you'll be really scrambling. So I think, you know, I think it just because there's a group of people who disagree with who think Christianity should not be investigated. Mm-hmm. Please don't take that to be what the real philosophical content of Christianity is. That's all.
Yeah, but like you said right there, like if. Like on the positions there, you know, of evolution, you got the young earth creationists and you got the old earth creationists and then you got the theistic evolutionists. And I, you know, from my experience, I went to a lot of different churches and this is not something they were going to ever talk about in church, and they're never going to have a class on this or anything because they just say it's divisive. And I don't see how you can get deeper intellectually when they refuse to talk about these things.
Yeah, and this, and you are reflecting my frustration in many churches. You know, it takes a lot of work to actually start teaching. Unfortunately, I don't go to one of those, but I've been to churches where there it's a lot of work to get them to start focusing on apologetics, right?
Yeah.
You know, you want them to, and they don't. They're like, no, that's too low. People lose people. People will. We'll disengage, and absolutely, and I think that is a big problem.
Well, I also see that as an atheist. I do a lot of debates, and I'm just finding in general there's very little appetite for this among anybody in the general population. Just most people, I don't know, it's just most people want to be entertained, I guess. I don't know, it's just, you know, because you got to have a background to understand what's going on. I don't know, it's the only people who are really interested in these kind of things are a very small group of people who are really intellectually seeking. It's a very small group of people. So.
Yeah.
Anyway, well, thanks for coming on, Neil. I appreciate the chance to show people that Christians and atheists can have a friendly discussion, and thanks for being a good role model in that.
Yeah, thank you very much for having me, and I appreciate the honor.
All right, we'll talk to you later. Take care.
Bye.